not knowing, like, it was already his heart rate, what caused his heart, and he was the only person they saw. So that's how it went.
The role of Clara, I think, changed a great deal in Peter's first season, whereas, you know, you're the impossible girl in that season, Clara's first. All of a sudden, from going from babysitter to she's a full-fledged teacher now. You know, she has fights with this new man. She's not quite. I mean, how much of the new relationship with Peter's Doctor Who sort of work out beforehand?
Well, you can't with Doctor Who because it's a show where you get up on your feet and you run with it, and that is how you shoot it. It's how you see the scripts. It's how it's very kind of organic, spontaneous, dynamic show. So in a way, you know, you go and you do your prep, but actually it's as much as about it's Peter arrives on set, I arrive on set, we throw kind of as much as we can at each other and try the scenes in a million different ways and then hand it over to the editors and see what happens. Like, it's a really interesting show to film, but it's something I think Stephen taught me straight away is be in the moment and react and see what happens. So in a way, we're not in control of it. And I think the relationship at 12 was really complicated, and I like that. And you know, the regeneration wasn't an easy thing. And I think that's what Stephen really wanted to address, is like, you're not just gonna go, oh, hey, best friend, you have a new face. Anyway, should we go adventure? It was like, it was complicated, and dealing with the change in that person, I felt like we really explored regeneration. Was that the question? Did I answer
that?
Well,
I think you did. Answer that a couple more. So
okay.
One of the tipping points, I think, of Clara and Twelve's relationship was at the end of Kill the Moon.
Yeah, that was a big argument, right?
Yes, you launched into this impassioned speech.
She was very angry.
She was very angry. She's almost frozen. You know, she's past the point of violence.
Yes.
Where you can still lash out, which is so much great. How much of that is directing, scripting, and your own?
It was an amazing script, a really, really great script, and it was a tense episode, and quite a dark episode, and quite a. I think it was the culmination of the regeneration and of this doctor no longer behaving like the person that she used to know. I think it was the culmination of all of that and for her and actually feeling abandoned in that moment, and that's never happened before. She's suddenly not, she didn't feel safe, I think, for a moment. So I think it had been building for like the 6 episodes and then all came out in that big, big row. But it was really great writing.
Samuel Anderson, of course, played your love interest for
the series. He's in cyber heaven right now.
Yes, he is, flying around.
Yeah, my boyfriend's a cyberman.
Everyone can say that.
Exactly.
How was it that sort of bringing him into this new doctor companion relationship? Like, there's sometimes like relationships on screen. I don't know, maybe transfer on screen, perhaps, and maybe yes. Huh? I mean, was sort of thinking like he's elbowing in on you and Peter's relationship as doctor companion.
Sorry, say that one again.
I'm just wondering if sometimes perhaps Samuel Anderson sort of felt like he was elbowing in on the relationship that you and Peter Cavalli are.
Well, he was never a traveling companion. So much of that series was the Clara split between her Earth life and her space life, and kind of trying to do both really unsuccessfully, living a double life. So he was obviously much part of the Earth life. I think Clara is a bit selfish with the TARDIS. I think she quite likes it, her and the Doctor.
One thing I want to ask, because I interviewed Craig Calloway, and there's a scene when you're throwing the keys in the lava.
Yeah.
And she said that you were upset because they shot Peter's scenes on the last day of the 1 foot day of filming. And then your scenes.
Yeah.
The first scene for the next day. And you were upset about, you felt you get your better performance reading lines to Peter as opposed to actually doing your own scenes. I mean, do you get frustrated when you feel that your past performances are not being captured on film?
I think it was just one of those scenes that had unfortunately been scheduled over 2 days. And I think sometimes when you, and especially an emotional scene and an important scene like that, you you find it when you pick it up on its feet and you start doing it. So then when you go home and go to sleep, you in the morning after, you're trying to get something back. And I think that was the way, it's just one of those things. It's the way it goes, you know. It's just the way when you're shooting a new schedule that sometimes happens.
It works.
Yeah.
It seems to be pretty good.
Yeah, it was a really good sleep.
Yeah. So in the Christmas special then, last Christmas, was it actually originally written then that you were going to leave as old Clara? Was that actually the Stephen Moffat? We're getting back to that again. Stephen Moffat said that he had written it and did that. And then where the doctor traveled back. And you're young again.
We decided to join the world tour to do another season.
Would you have felt comfortable if you had left at the end of that Christmas special?
I think it would have been unfinished. There was more stories to tell. It wasn't done yet. It wasn't time, but there was just more stories to tell. There was more to do, and I don't think I could have walked away with it feeling unfinished.
Perhaps don't want to spoil it, of course, but for the series now, it's roughly every 2 episodes in. What was it like in these like two parts? And that the longer, there's part stories, they're not like as cut and dry as 25-minute episodes. Did that change the production of anything apart from making everything a little bit longer?
It gives you 90 minutes to be able to go to a planet and explore the characters and tell a story. It gives you the opportunity to have cliffhangers, which is great. So I think it really worked, because 45 minutes to go to a planet and meet the bad guys, tell the story, is not very long set up, really, and to also explore the characters that we meet. So to have 90 minutes to do that time is also really great. And cliffhangers are just brilliant, and I think Stephen's got some brilliant ones this season.
This isn't a spoiler, because it's been all over the place that Missy is back for this part of the series. What was it working with Michelle Gomez again after ending the last series and then starting the new series with her?
She is brilliant. Yeah, she's absolutely bananas. You do not know what she's going to do take to take. In the most brilliant way, bananas. And also really funny, really kind. But I mean, it's really difficult because you kind of forget Clara doesn't like Missy because, well, she's the master. She's also kind of responsible for her boyfriend being a sideman. But the problem is working with Michelle. She's so funny. You're sucked in by her because she's really magnetic, and you end up really liking her and keep having to like check yourself. You're like, no, wait, Clara doesn't like you. But it's so funny. So it's that kind of that push and pull.
Are you in the whole series? Can you even say that much?
I ain't telling you that.
I thought I'd ask.
I know, nice try.
There are certain people lining up. I'll ask one more question though, because I want to know about your next project, which is playing a young Queen Victoria.
Yeah.
Tell me about that.
I am in prep at the moment to play Queen Victoria for when she came to the throne. I'm currently learning how to horse ride in a couple of weeks. It's going to be interesting. Yeah, it's exciting.
How has it been everyone sort of has this ideal of what Queen Victoria was like.
Yeah.
No one has there's no recordings of it or anything like that. So how do you sort of work on portraying a character that everybody knows?
Because she's written diaries in her land. She has over 60 million words, they think, that are all in her hand. So you can see her voice on the page, which is pretty incredible for source material. Reading a lot of biographies and looking at that.
Very cool. Okay, yeah. Let's go to that one right there first.
So Clara has some like really awesome villains and some really awesome scenes. So what was your favorite episode to film?
The Snowman holds a really special place in my heart, and I think it's the fairy tale-ness I love of that episode. And I think also it's kind of like the first time Clara gets to meet the Doctor, the first time she starts running with him, the first time she's the TARDIS, you know, all those special key moments. So that, and also the TARDIS on the cloud, the staircase, and Snowman that will eat you. It was a really good episode. And Strax.
Right over there.
Hi.
When you're Doctor Who, which I know you are.
Yes.
When you're doctor? Did you have a lot of fun with them?
I cannot tell you how much fun. Like, I've never laughed as much in my life as I have laughed on Doctor Who, like, every single day. I'll go to work and there is not a day where Matt wouldn't make fun of me in some way, or play some prank, or do something silly, like a big brother. And Peter is so funny. We're both like kindergarten children together. I think the crew gets sick of us because we're constantly just... Actually, we repeat the same jokes that we find hilarious, but everyone's just like, oh my goodness, 9 months. 9 months of this, but we're just like children. We're ridiculous, but I mean, we get really giddy and excited. So we have to like separate ourselves, otherwise we'll tire ourselves out too quickly. We have a whole day to shoot, so he'll go sit on that part of the TARDIS, and I'll go sit over there so we don't get too overexcited. And we have to like pace ourselves.
Thank you. Right there.
Hi, Jenna.
Hi, nice costume.
So, speaking of your departure, what is the legacy you hold to leave being a
Souffle girl! You can't make a souffle. Well, the impossible girl, the girl who is constantly traveling through time and space, chasing after the doctor. I'm being ignored for the most part. Filming with William Hartnell, the 50th anniversary, Peter, Matt. It's really exciting. A school teacher who saves the world, I think that's really cool as well. There's so much. I think Stephen has been incredible. Yeah, there's lots.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And
really. Hi.
Doctor Who?
Ever? The ones I've been in, or other ones?
The ones that you have been in.
Ooh, there's a really cool one this season, Vikings. And also I love Listen. And I thought Dark Lord of Death and Heaven were really good. I jumped in the breath. And I really like The Snowman again as well. Lots of favourites. But the ones I'm not in, I love Vincent and the Doctor. Yeah, it's great, isn't it? And I also love The 11th Hour as well. Yeah, they're cool.
Thank you.
What's your favourite movie?
Oh, that's such a big question, like ever. There's a French film that I love called Betty Blue. Has anyone seen it? Yes, one person. Woo! Betty Blue, watch it, it's brilliant, it's a classic. And also the Bringing Up Baby as well. The first film I actually remember seeing in the cinema which made me cry was My Girl. And I remember being so overwhelmed because the glasses and the beard and that's the first time I think something like a film had made me cry when I went to the cinema and I was really young. So I remember that quite vividly.
Thanks for your question.
Who do you think the scariest bad guy was in Doctor Who?
Ooh, I think the scariest to film with was Peter, who played Half-Face Man. He was fantastic in Deep Breath, and he had all the cogs in his head, and he was all like animatronic and robotic, and he was really scary to work with. I think he was probably the most scared, like, real life of me in a different nice way, Peter, if you're watching this, in a way that you're a really good actor way. Also, the whispering around can be scary, and the silence. I like the ones that move slowly. Because there's something about the confidence of like a villain being like, I'm gonna get hit, I don't need to walk fast. That really scares me.
Thanks for the question.
Hi, it's Clara,
my special. I would say she loves Jane Austen, and that is open to interpretation. I've been to the one in San Diego twice, and then probably about three or four since then. So not a huge amount. How about you? How many you do? Woohoo!
This is about the first episode of season 9.
Yeah.
Where you have that line about Jane Austen.
Yes.
And then you also have another one in Asylum of the Dollars.
Yes. Yes.
So, is Clara my essential?
Clara and Oscar are not really echoes of each other. They are not the same, well, I suppose they are the same person. Oh, this is writing Stephen. She has a relationship with Jane Austen. I love those lines, I think they're hilarious. And it is open to interpretation.
Next question.
Who's your favorite companion, not including the dog?
I think my favorite is Amy Pond. I love my relationship with Matt. I love the story they told of meeting him as a child and then waiting for him to come back and then he came back. I just thought the whole and the way that it came full circle and the letter she wrote at the end, I just thought it was a really wonderful story about friendship and adventure. And they were really funny together. I really liked those guys.
Steve, thank you for the podcast, first of all. It's fantastic.
Oh, you're mighty kind to say that.
It's really good. If you're a doctor who's fan, you can keep listening to every week. Jenna,
I'll pay $5 for
it. I'm not playing. Jenna, thanks for coming. I was wondering, when you took on the role of Clara, did you have to go into a room with a book and say, this is everything doctor need that you need to know? Is there like a class you're going to take?
No, but I was really keen because I felt very acutely aware of, I started filming on episode 6 and I didn't have the first 5 episodes. So when I started filming, I had no idea how I met the doctor, what I'd done, you know, and for me, I love prep and, you know, so I was saying to Stephen, like, you know, what about this? And, you know, I feel like, you know, should I go back and watch this? And he was like, do you know what? As the companion, you come into this show and into this world having never met an alien, not knowing what the TARDIS is, you know, you don't know the doctor and what he's going to do and how he reacts. So he said, so do that, use it. And as you are experiencing everything for the first time with your eyes, react and do the same because, you know, you're not the doctor who has lived for 2,000 years and knows everything. You're the companion who's walking into this world not knowing. So it was a case of doing that, which was quite a brave step, I think, to take. So I tried to do that and happening again. Okay.
Right over there.
Hi.
Hi, Jenna. Again.
Hello,
nice to meet you again.
Nice to meet you again.
Well, first statement.
Yes.
You said you went to a steakhouse last night. And
yes.
I worked at a steakhouse downtown.
All right.
And I took the night off.
Oh.
So, possibly could have came into my work and I didn't know about it.
Possibly.
Anyways, question.
Yes.
So, the scene with Peter Capaldi, with the guitar, playing any Van Halen place, standing on top of a tank,
yep.
Was, excuse the volume, awesome! So, was that planned by Stephen Moffat, or was that Peter Capaldi's idea?
Stephen's! He just said to us, he was like, okay, I've written episode 1, it's great, and he just looked at me through, he's like, you got an entrance. but Peter's mentioned to Stephen that I'd love to have a guitar in the TARDIS. You know, we always talk about things that we could have in there to make it more like homely or little bits and pieces. I keep making jokes that I'm like, I want to draw. You know, because Clara hasn't moved into the TARDIS, so I keep winding Peter up. Like, Peter wants a desk, so I'm like, I'll have a desk next to you, Peter, where I want to draw to move my things in. It was kind of, it was Peter's idea for the guitar that Stephen took on and then ran with it.
He plays, Peter Capaldi.
He plays, yeah, he's good. He's in his trailer playing a lot.
Hey, really?
Yeah, yeah. To knock on Peter, turn it down.
Thanks a lot.
Thank
you. Thanks a lot. Hope to see you again.
You too.
Yeah. Autograph session right after the show. Right there.
Hi.
Hi, Jenna. Welcome to Edmonton.
Thank you. I like your dress.
Yes.
First of all, how was the experience working with both the 11th and the 12th Doctor? Is there much of a difference between working with Matt Smith and working with Peter Capaldi?
It's obviously it is different, but I mean, they both just are their own things. But they're really, you know, they're both inventive, they're both kind, they're both incredibly generous, they're both very mercurial as doctors, they're kind of fearless as well, they're hilarious, they're silly. You know, so it'll be interesting to see them ever working together, but their doctors are so, so different. But as actors, they're kind of, you know, all about trying as much as they can, which is why, I think, to be honest, it's the thing that why a lot of people are cast as the doctor if you're really mercurial and inventive, I suppose, and it's what they both are.
Okay. My second thing is,
it
just make my day
year
month girl.
Go on. Hit me. Okay, I think I have to. Run, you clever boy, and remember. You're welcome. Nice to meet you.
Right over there.
Hi.
Hi.
Who's my crush? Is that the question? Ooh, good question.
Don't say Jane Austen.
You stole it. Jane Austen is my crush. She is. Pride and Prejudice.
But you can read whatever you need to.
So you've been the companion of two doctors now, and you've worked with three.
I technically did a scene with William Hartnell, just saying.
Sure. What's your favorite part about each doctor?
Focus, you son of a bitch.
Doctors or people?
Doctors.
Doctors? I like that Peter is like a space scandal. That he is like really kind of mythical and unknowable and, what's the word? Like, what's the word? Where. You don't always know what he's thinking. Like he's kind of
mysterious.
Yeah, kind of mysterious. Yeah, he is mysterious, but oh god, this is a really good word. Inscrutable. He is inscrutable. But also he's you can believe he's 2,000 years old. No offense to Peter. But the thing about Matt, which I always loved, because do you know what it is? Peter is, he physically looks older, but he's got the glint of a boy in his eye. And whereas Matt had this incredible quality that he looked so young, but yet he had these eyes that again could betray an age, or like he's seen, and his wisdom, and he's seen the world, and he could be like 1,800 years old. You know, so it's really interesting qualities that have kind of both been flipped on their heads, the older versus the younger, the boy inside the man inside the boy, getting very deep.
Thank you.
Hello, Jenna.
Hi.
First, I'd like to thank you on behalf of everyone here for coming to our little city.
Thank you. Nice to be here.
My question was, I've been a doctor who's been for a really long time, and I find that Clara is most reminiscent of Elizabeth Slade's Sarah Jane Smith, a character that I thought was completely irreplaceable. As we've already touched on it a little bit, where Clara is having a really hard time sort of in the beginning accepting that this new doctor is the same doctor that she knew before, after three generations.
Uh-huh.
And I'm wondering if Clara ever feels like perhaps she can't replace maybe a previous companion to the doctor's life, that he, you know, whether it's aging or whether it's a past companion, or whether she feels like she is not filling that void.
I don't think it's something that we've ever really played. Like, we'll always do things for comedy, like the Doctor, you know, like in Deep Breath, there's a funny line where the Doctor says, like, I wish Amy was here because Clara's legs are too short, you know, to grab a screwdriver. So I think that's really funny, but You know, I suppose she's a wacky, she's obviously been many other companions, but I think, to be honest, it's about enjoying their adventure and their time together and being that relationship. And, you know, it's really interesting because as soon as I was cast, it was like, you know, people saying, how does it feel? You're replacing Karen Gillan. And it's actually, you're not. You're coming in and creating a new relationship and a new thing. Karen can't be replaced. You know, it's, so that's how you have to take each relationship. And the same with, you know, whoever comes after me, it's something new and it's been its own thing. And that's great. And that's what's so good about the show, that it can be generated and keep moving and become new things all the time. So I think you have to allow that to happen. You're welcome.
Hello. Hi. Since everyone here is a pretty big fan of Doctor Who, I was wondering, is there anything that you're a big fan of?
Jane Austen. Jane Austen is featuring a lot today. I love to read. I'm a big Daphne du Maurier fan. I like Woody Allen, Sofia Coppola films. There's lots of things. I'm a fan of films. I used to collect My Little Ponies as well.
You're in the right place for that.
Yeah, and Sylvanian Families also used to collect them.
Great then.
What's your favorite comic book superhero villain?
Villain? Superhero. I liked Andrew Garfield's Spider-Man. And putting him and Emma Stone together were great. Iron Man films. I like the Iron Man. Captain America. Yeah, I probably should have said that on the first time, shouldn't I? Captain America, yes. I really did. That was a great film. If I say so. Hello.
Right there.
Hi. I was wondering which episode, only in season 8, was the most fun or the one you liked best to film?
Let's think. In the Forest of the Night was fun. With all the kids in the TARDIS and the school trip and being out and creating London and having like tube stops in the forest and often, especially like when we're filming in summer and we do episodes outside, we kind of felt a little bit Jurassic Park-y because of the scale of the forest and stuff we're in. That one was a really fun episode. You know, one of the girls is the voice of Peppa Pig. Do you have Peppa Pig over here? Yeah. Little fact for you. Thanks.
Thank you. Right there.
Yes.
What's your favorite role you've ever played?
I mean, Clara Osmond Oswald is pretty. It's pretty high up there. I think, you know, I get to run away from monsters, save the world. My best friend's an alien. It's a pretty good job.
The 12th Doctor, right there.
Hello.
Hello again.
Hi.
First off, thank you once again for coming in to like this just whole be my whole expo, my favorite companion coming to my city. My question for you is, and my favorite scene in season 8 is actually in Dark Water at the very beginning when you're threatening him in the dreamlike volcano. It's like,
yeah,
bro, like I'll throw away the key. That's what I'm thinking too. My question to you is, was it like killing those really tense scenes between you and the Doctor, especially seeing as you and Peter are really good friends?
Peter's such a good actor. I mean, that's what's so amazing about, if there's ever a scene that I'm in doubt about, or I don't quite know how I'm going to play this, the good thing is we've got such that trust in each other that you can arrive on set and I can just look at Peter and he'll do something to me, or he'll throw me in some way or surprise me. And if I just connect into his eyes, it's great, it does all my work for me. It's incredible, and it's because he's such a good actor and he's such a generous actor. So scenes like that are a joy because, again, it's the relationship is so complex. And I don't think we've ever really seen a companion and a doctor kind of go to those extremes before, and those lengths before. And as well, it came from grief, you know, so I think she was acting not as herself either. So it's a really interesting scene to play. It was a great scene, but it was dark and threatening and complicated. It was a lot of fun.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Hi, Andrew.
Hi. Good times.
First off, my girlfriend was very happy to know she's just an inch taller than you when we did the photo. Not saying it's sad, just she's very happy to know she's an inch taller than you. My question was, when you've done the script reads, has there ever been a script that you've just been flabbergasted about, like something that's going to be done for example, the tank in the beginning of the season?
Every single script is like that. With Stephen, his imagination is like unfathomable. Like you never know what direction he's going to go in. But what you do know is you're reading it, it's like a page turner. Like I get so excited when a new script comes through and like I kind of save it, especially so I can sit down and read it because his imagination is just, it's unstoppable. But Name of the Doctor was a really, I got to like the first 7 pages where we reveal the echoes and Clara going through time and space meeting all the doctors. And I was just turning the page like this. And then when it got to the titles, I kind of had to put it down for a minute. And I was just like, oh my, this is so cool. So that was a particular one that I remember. And I think I like texted my mum before I like carried on reading it as well.
The last question belongs to you.
Dun, dun, dun.
My friend was wondering if you could be a companion for any other doctor, who would it be?
Tom Baker. That was his voice right there.
It was. Nice.
You might have thought he was in the room, but it was just me.
Awesome. One last question. Can Peter and Stephen sit you down and ambush you to stay here series 10?
Don't give them the idea. Don't do it. It's good. It's a good story. We'll see what happens, but it's been amazing. It's been a really special time.
And it's been lovely having you here today, everybody. Jenna Coleman, everybody. And everyone go over to her autograph table for half an hour to be signing autographs if you can do that.